Acts chapter 20, and you guessed it, verse 20. 20:20. I want to preach this morning from Acts 20:20. And look what it says. And how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, but have showed you and have taught you publicly and from house to house. That's our vision for 2020. I want to preach this morning on 2020 vision. The Bible said in Acts 20:20, Paul said, my ministry was going to you, teaching you the Bible, and going from house to house. Can't think of anything any greater than that. God's been good to us this year. I won't take time to reflect, but just think about it. The spring, our Easter sunrise services, all the blessings, the big day we had on Easter, then the youth rally with over 50 souls saved and probably another 150 rededications. Then we went over to camp in July over in Tennessee and had 11 or 12 kids saved. We had Bible school. We had camp meeting just a few weeks ago and just got back from winter camp this year. I didn't keep up with it, but I usually travel between 30 and 40,000 miles a year by car, not counting flying. And I was allowed, the Lord blessed me in over 20 different revivals, camp meetings. I don't know how many states I preached in this year. God, again, was good to me this year. I count that an honor. I've been doing this a long time, and it's just year after year. I've been doing that since I was 19. And today, at 104, I still was allowed to do that. Don't laugh. Don't laugh. Some of y'all ain't looking so hot either. Listen, God's been good to me this year. He's been really, really good to me. Something popped up on my phone the other day. News articles just pop up. I didn't look at it, but it said, check your horoscope for 2020. See what's going to happen for you in this coming new year. Look at this. And I didn't look at it. I don't think Christian has no business looking at a horoscope. Amen. We're not superstitious, right, and we don't follow demonic ways of trying to divine the future like that. We got a Bible that tells us what to do. We got a Holy Spirit that leads us into our future. And it's not always clear. We don't always know exactly what we'll be facing in the year ahead. Somebody said it like this. We are standing on the threshold. We are in the open door. We're treading a borderline we've never trod before. Another year is opening. And another year is gone. We've passed the darkness of the night. We're in the early morn. We've left the fields behind us over which we've scattered seed. We pass into the future that none of us can read. Then hasten to fresh labor to thresh and reed and sow. Then let the old year gone and take the new year up. And let the old year go. 2020. Have you ever wondered what people say, what's your eyesight? And you say it's 2020. You don't know what that means? 2020 vision means what a normal person can see clearly, a kid, a teenager maybe, at 20 feet. Like from here to that wall right there. I can see that clearly. 2040. People say, a doctor says you got 20/40 vision. It means a person with 20/20 vision can see at 20 feet what it, or 40 feet what it takes you 20 to see. In other words, here's 40 right here. And if I can see something clearly at 40 feet and you have to get over there to 20 to see it, that's 20/40 vision. 20/40. It takes you 20 feet to see something a normal person can see at 40. That's where we get that. 20, 80, 20, 100, you know, blind. And somebody might check me on this, but I think 2200 is considered legally blind. That means it would take a person at 200 feet over there on the other side of the road, over there at that wall, that bank, could see what it would take you 20 feet. You could only see it 20 feet. That's 2200. That's bad. You better be careful out driving like that. But that's what 2020 vision is. And, you know, if you go to an eye checkup, get your license, or go to the eye doctor, they always have them, this great big E about that big on the wall. And there's an E and a R and an S. And the doctor said, can you see that top line? Yeah, I can see that top line. What about that next one? A little bit E-S-V-O-T. A little bit littler. R-P-Q-G-L. A little bit of E. And he said, now, can you see that little one? And I said, what'd I get if I can see that? He said, that's 2015. And I used to could do that 2015. I can't do that anymore. But I still got real good in I think it's this one or that one, at that level. And I can almost see them little bitty ones. And then he'll put them things on you. And he'll put it like that. And what he'll do is he'll say, can you see it now? Lord, no. It looks like a smudge. All right? Click. There it is, right there. Isn't it amazing? Y'all know what I'm talking about? When they make you put your face up there against that little thing, and he does a little old thing like that, and it gets clear as a bell. That's amazing. It's like a miracle happens just right there in front of your face. I mean, it's nothing but a black smudge, and now it's plain as day. That's what I'd like for us to do. Shining Light Baptist Church, let's let the Lord just sort of, you know, we need to focus, if you want to sound like modern day, focus a little bit, see clearly what our vision should be for 2020. Let me say a few things and we'll go. Seriously, be very quick. Number one, I want you to see this clearly this year, and that is your own personal relationship with the Lord. Your own personal relationship. I would say this morning that the most important thing in the world as a Christian, are you listening to me? The most important thing in your life is your personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. I think a lot of times we think, well, is he still serving God? Yeah, he comes to church every Sunday. I read my Bible every day. I try to pray every day. I try to do this. I try to give. I try to participate. Somebody needs help. I try to help them. You can do all them things and still not be where you need to be with God. Your personal relationship with God is your most important thing in your life. How many times you hear about somebody and they fall into sin? And you thought, oh my goodness, what happened to them? They was just up in the choir last Sunday. They go to church every Sunday. I'll tell you what happened. They kept going through the motions and doing right when their own personal relationship wasn't right. You backslide in your heart a long time before you backslide with your body. There's people sitting right here this morning. You're doing the right things. You're sitting where you're supposed to sit. You go to church, you pay your bills, you're good to your family, but your heart is not where it needs to be. And that is the most important thing, your personal relationship with God. You know what you need to do? Don't let nothing or nobody stop you from having a personal relationship with the Lord. They said nothing is settled right till it's settled with God. Nothing is settled right till it's settled with God. If you're in here and you have a fuss with your wife or your husband, or you talk wrong, or you're a smart aleck, or you get hateful with them or something like that, and you go over here, your conscience is bothering you, or you acted out at work, acted like you shouldn't act, it ain't never going to be settled till you settle it with God. I've known people that said, well, I really messed up, Brother Danny. And I said, well, you pray about it? And they said, no, I'm afraid to go to the Lord. I know he's mad at me, and I'm afraid. That's the dumbest thing you can do. Listen, immediately when you fail, immediately, right then, go to God and say, Lord, I'm sorry. Fix this up. I don't want nothing. It's like you do with your husband and your wife. Don't you want to keep things, right between each other? That's what you got to do with the Lord. Keep it right. All right, number two, what else should be our focus in 2020, and that would be God's Word, the Bible. We've already said a lot about it this morning, but I think you should read the Bible. We got criticized a time or two because I've heard people say, well, you stay up and read it. Like Brother Mike said, your eyes burning, you don't remember it, it don't do you any good. I don't believe that. I've done it 1,000 times like that. It does do you good. God looks down and sees your heart. Listen, you have to discipline that flesh. We've even been criticized. People say, well, it don't do that good just to read the Bible. You should study the Bible. That's a half-truth. You should do both. The Bible says, study to show thyself approved. You should study it. I've had people say, well, Brother Danny, when I start reading it, I run into something I get interested in, and then I just quit reading it and just study that one subject. Mistake. You should do both. You should study the Bible. You should read the Bible. 1 Timothy 4:13 said, till I come, give attendance to reading. Isaiah 34 and verse 16 said, seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read. Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word. That's Habakkuk. That's Philemon. That's Obadiah. That's Nahum. That's the book of Amos. That's every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God shall man live. Somebody said the Bible is a book worth all other books. Somebody said the Bible is truth without any mixture of error. There's no poison in this. It's not diluted with an error and mistake here and there. It is the Word of God. It has 1,189 inspired chapters. It has 31,175 verses. It has 810,697 words and 3,566,480 letters. That's what your King James Bible had. You can read 5 chapters a day and read 3 in the Old, 2 in the New, and read the whole Old Testament through by December, and the New Testament 3 times. That's only 5 per day at a steady rate. And ladies and gentlemen, that nobody in here is too busy to spend 70 hours between now and this time next year. You can read 10 chapters a day and read the Old Testament 3 times, or maybe the whole thing 3 times, easily through the year. 5 in the Old, 2 in the New, or the other way around. It will help you direct your decision. It'll come back to you. 2 or 3 people up here a minute ago said, the scripture came back to me. The Lord said he'd bring it to your remembrance. He ain't gonna bring it to your remembrance, you ain't never read it. I know a man right now. He's a big old guy. He's a truck driver, big old arms about that big around. And he'd read the Bible all the time, listened to preaching all the time when he's gone. And he was he was saved, but he still had enough man and redneck in him that you didn't want to mess with him. You know what I mean? And I appreciate a man. I don't think just because you're a Christian you should turn into a sissy. You still are a man after you're saved. And he said he came home from work one day, and somebody told him, he said, your neighbor over there has been sneaking around trying to get your wife. And he said when he heard that man been over there trying to mess with his wife, he said the blood went through his head. He said he went and grabbed his gun. He said he was over there, and he was on his way to kill his neighbor. And he said halfway over to his neighbor's house, he said the Lord spoke to him just as plain as day, and that scripture said, vengeance is mine, I will repay. Amen. And he said, Brother Danny, it stopped me. He said, that verse stopped me. I turned around, put my gun up, and I said, all right, God, I'm going to leave it up to you. And he said, that one verse of scripture kept me out of prison for murder. Listen to me. You don't think that thing's valuable? It'll make you make the right decisions. It'll help you go through the day and put into practice what you've read. It makes you more tenderhearted and easier to get along with. It makes you not so self-centered and egotistical. It'll make you nicer to your wife. It'll make you nicer to your husband. It'll make you more patient with your children. I mean, the book, it'll keep you in line. This book will keep you from sin, or sin will keep you from this book. You're not going to keep sinning and reading the Bible, and you're not going to keep from reading the Bible and still sinning. You'll quit one or the other. Amen. Get you a new focus in it. Amen? That's right. any society. I heard somebody say the other day, they said America's doing great and America's wonderful, da, 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 da. They said we are at a 50-year low in unemployment in this country. And if that's true, hallelujah, praise God. But I'm going to tell you something, brother, the wrath of God's on this country. God Almighty is not happy with this. Let me tell you what God says about this country. It don't matter what the news said. Let me tell you what God said. God said the wicked will be turned into hell and all the nations that forget God. This ain't a good time in America. Our nations forgot God. We are in trouble under the judgment of God. You know where you get that? The Bible. You know what makes me think straight? The Bible. You know what makes me level-headed? The Bible. Ask Kelly, ask my daughter, sitting over there. Everything that comes up, we filter it through the scripture. What about that? What does the Bible say? What does the Bible say? Somebody said that one time, the preacher said, well, can't you talk without quoting the Bible? No, ain't no use to. I mean, it don't mean nothing, just blabbing words. What's wrong with quoting the Bible, brother? You're going to quote Socrates, or you'll quote Darwin. What's wrong with quoting the Bible? And let me encourage you this year, use your sword. That's what it's for. Give them the scripture. Give them the scripture. I found myself doing them guys over at the gym playing ball and stuff, and someone come out and say, the Bible says, the Bible says, the Bible says. And that way it's not just your opinion. I think, well, you know, opinions are like armpits. Everybody got two, they both stink. That's what your opinion is. And mine too. But I'm telling you this morning, what the Bible says is right. What the Bible says is right. It don't matter if grandma had a dream, 14 angels come in her bedroom and told her this. What the Bible said, yea, let God be true and every man a liar. And I'm going to tell you this morning in 2020, we're not forsaking the word of God. We still believe what we did this time last year and the year before 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 and the year before. The world ain't never made an improvement on this book. They ain't never had a mistake in this book. The book is still right. And if you'll guide your life by this book, you'll stay out of trouble. And if you don't, you're going to mess your life up. Amen. Focus on God's word. Number three, let's focus on God's ways. We need to just focus on God's ways. You do believe his ways are still right in 2020, don't you? I do. It's still right for a young couple to wait till they get married before they go to bed with each other. Still right. Brother Danny, that's asking too much. Still right. Brother Danny, they ain't none of them going to do that. It's still right. If everybody in the world does different, it's still right. You young people in here this morning, you make up your mind you're going to keep yourself pure and a virgin until you walk down that aisle and give your life to the person that God's chosen of you. Tell them, the rest of us, we can tell them you'll mess up trying it any other way. You get it backwards. You get the cart before the horse. Well, we want to live together, see if we like each other. You'll never have a good shack up or a marriage like that. I'm telling you, you honor God and do right, he'll bless your marriage. Amen. And if you've already messed up, ask God to forgive you and clean you, start all over again, stay pure. Sure, it's not the end of the world. Stay right. We still believe it's right to live a separated life. There should be a difference in a Christian. Oh, I know we're living in this day when people say, Jesus, hang out with sinners. No, you got that all wrong, buddy. Jesus didn't hang out with sinners. He went and preached to sinners, but he was always separate, holy, undefiled, without sin. Jesus never participated. Jesus didn't go down at the bar and sit around with a bunch of sinners and have a beer and play cards with them. He might have went down there, but it was to preach them the gospel and tell them. There was always different. There should always be a difference in a child of God. The way you act, the way you look, the way you dress, the places you go, the music you listen to, the movies you watch, it ought to be honor God. Every bit of it ought to honor God. I know it's old-fashioned, but it's still right anyway. And what you just heard is so rare today that people think I'm a terrible, awful person for even saying something like that. I'm nice to what them old preachers was 75 years ago. So you know what the old preachers used to say? I'll tell you what they used to say. They said a dancing foot and a praying knee don't grow on the same leg. How's that for being sweet and nice and sharing the love of Jesus? It's still right to be a teetotaler. It's still right to say no to the wine glass. And no to the alcohol and the mixed drink and the cannabis or whatever in the world it is they're trying to legalize. All that stuff, it'll heal anything. It just make you think you're all right. I'm just kidding, but I don't know about all that stuff. But I'll tell you one thing, brother. You know why preachers don't preach on alcohol no more? Some of them got wine in the refrigerator, and the deacons got it in their refrigerator, and the Sunday school teachers, they go out on Friday night and have a little glass of wine or that. Listen, you're looking at one old redneck preacher. I still believe in teetotalism. I believe you're better off never to touch it. You're better off never to look at it. The Bible said don't look on the wine when it moves itself. That means after it's fermented. You can drink all that unfermented you want. It's grape juice. That's what new wine is in the Bible. Help yourselves. Good for you. Good for you. But I'm telling you this morning, in 2020, make up your mind. You say, well, Brother Danny, I go to these work parties and it worked. It ain't going to kill you, big baby. Turn it down. Say no. You might be an inspiration to help somebody else. God one time said he didn't like me because of my teetotalism. Whatever that means, I'll take it if it means I don't drink.
Yes, sir.
What kind of a nut drinks? What are you thinking? The Bible said, wine is a mocker. Strong drink is raging. And whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. That's liquid devil, people. That stuff will put you in an early grave. It'll mess you up, make you think things you shouldn't think. You say, well, Brother Danny, I just have a little sip every night. You can take melatonin for that. You get older, your body quits making melatonin, you can buy it at the dollar store and go to sleep. Now, you'll dream grandma's flowing on a witch, like in through your wind and everything else, but you will sleep. I say, may cause vivid dreams. Lord, that's the truth. That's why when you get older, you can't sleep all night. Just take little naps all the time. You quit making melatonin. But anyway, it's still right. It's still right in 2020 to refuse to go to the parties where you know stuff's going on you ain't got no business being around. You say, it's required. Listen, you tell them you're going to get you a lawyer and tell them they don't have to require you go to some hellhole somewhere and that like that. Hey, listen, you know that's what's wrong with the world today. Christians won't stand up for nothing and ain't got no confidence in them. They don't see no difference between you and them. It's still right to refuse. Turn the music off when it's wrong music. Amen. Still wrong, listen to music that tells you to sin.
Amen.
I ain't talking about the words. Music. Music. I ain't got time to get into that. It's still right to go to church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, Sunday school. People say, y'all have church three times a week? Do you honestly think that's too much? Have you been out? Have you looked? Let me tell you, if you heard them stories I heard just in at camp this week, church kids and bus kids, families all to pieces, the devil coming in ruining homes, people sitting right here this morning going through divorce and everything else, you honest to God think it's time to back off and start going to church less? Lord, have mercy, no. The Bible said no much the more as you see the day approach. You know what some of you people here ought to do? You ought to get your lens straightened up, 2020, and say, you know what? I'm going to get my priorities straight. I'm going to quit laying out of church for every little old thing that comes along. I'm not going to let little things keep me out of the house of God. I'm going to start next Sunday morning. I'm going to get in there. I'm going to be dedicated. Get 2020 vision on God's ways. And you're giving your tithes. Y'all. I heard somebody say not long ago that somebody worked for years in a church, and you know what they said? That person's family said that church just used them to work for it all these years. Listen, that's a wicked, perverted, satanic way of looking at that thing, buddy. If you do what you do for the church, for the Lord, and you do it with a sincere heart, you are not wasting your time. You are not wasting your money. Every dollar you put in that offering plate, everything you do with a sincere heart, ever to help a bus kid, help anybody else, the Bible, let me tell you what the Bible says. The Bible said your labor is not in vain. The Bible said God sees it. The Bible said you'll reap what you sow. And that verse on reap what you sow, First, talking about good stuff, not bad stuff. And you'll sow to the flesh, you reap corruption. But if you sow good things, you'll reap good things. You're not wasting time. I've had people say, Brother Danny, don't you just get tired of going every Sunday morning and Sunday night screaming at people and they don't listen to you? And then they stab you in the back and quit and don't even tell you why and just hurt you and everything like that. I said, I mean, it hurts, but I don't get tired of it. I'm not doing it for them. I'm doing what I'm doing this morning because I'm convinced this is what God wants me to do. Amen. By God's grace, I'm going to do it. If the devil says, you're getting old, Brother Danny, don't you think you ought to back off? Oh, I think I'll do double this year. Amen. Thank you for that word of encouragement. He'll leave you alone. Yeah. He'll leave you alone. The devil says, oh, you can't do that no more. Okay, we'll do twice that. How about that? I'm going to start 2 or 3 more bus routes. I like that. Amen. You said, Lord, I was hoping you'd back. No, no, it's 2020. This used to be sci-fi stuff when we talked about 20. I remember thinking back when it was, I remember in 1997, 98, and 2001, 2020, Lord, there'll be flying cars and robots run the world, and we are headed for that, but it ain't here yet. The grace of God give us a little grace time. I remember when we thought 2020, Lord, everybody be floating around in flying cars and stuff, but listen, it is 2020. Can you believe that? 2020. Let's not back up. It's not time to do less. It's time to do more. It's time, if you do less, you don't really believe in eternity. If you believe in eternity, you'll do more. I'll say this and I'm through. Focus on God's work. If you heard the stories that I've heard this week, some of y'all would grab one of these bus kids and say, next Sunday, don't you go home with me? And take them and feed them and talk to them and bring them back to church Sunday night and take them home. I'm telling you, I wish that I could say there's too many people sitting right in here who know too much. I can't do it, but I wish I could tell y'all the stories. We had a girl there, not from our church, this week at camp. Her pastor told me, said her daddy is a registered terrorist. Registered terrorist. We had a 14-year-old boy with us at camp this week. Pastor told me, he said, his daddy, that boy's daddy, every morning dresses up in high heels and a dress. Boy. I'm going to tell you something, people. That's how sick and perverted this world is. Amen. And the bad thing about it is our young people are getting accustomed to junk like that. Like it's cute. Hey, back where I come from, boys don't act like that. Oh, Brother Danny, you're just old fashioned. Yeah, whatever. We're going to be that way in 2022 by the grace of God. You ain't better off getting messed up like that. We used to call everybody in the phone book. Get the phone book. Go down the A's, B's, C's. Have people divide up. Call everybody house to house. Get out tracks. It works. Instead of quitting, you say, oh, I think I'm going to give up the bus ministry this year, Brother Danny. I've been in it for 3 or 4 or 5 years. No, 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 no. Maybe you ought to think about doubling your route. Maybe you ought to think about this might be the year Jesus comes. This might be our last chance. We're going to do more for God than we've ever done before. Let's go out with a bang, y'all. Amen. If the Lord takes us out of here in the rapture, let's go out in a blaze of glory. Amen. Some bumper stickers. Put them on your car. Instead of trying to use God for your benefit, there's a church out there, that Bethel Church in Redding, California, one of the most famous churches in America, hooked up with that Heidi Baker people and all them people. They think they're apostles, and we have the gift of the apostles now. You've probably seen it. It's on the internet, and it's sad. Now, that one of their worship leaders, whatever in the world that is, a worship leader, whatever in the world that is, in the Bible, a 2-year-old baby died. And they put it out all over the internet. They was meeting, having prayer meetings. God's going to raise that kid from the dead. And of course, he didn't. And Bill Johnson, the pastor, you said, I'm not trying to be ugly to them. They're good people. They love the Lord. They just don't understand the Bible. They think we're in a kingdom. They think we're apostles. And they don't understand. They're not an apostle. And they had thousands of people all over America praying that God would raise that two-year-old kid from the dead. And now they're the life and stock of the United States. It's on the internet. Look, it's all over it. And I'm not being ugly. If I had a two-year-old baby that died, my heart breaks for them people. But look at it this way. If you got a two-year-old in heaven, leave them there, man. You wouldn't want them to come back in this mess, would you? And God didn't raise him from the dead. Wouldn't it be better off just to do what God said and go house to house and tell somebody that don't know the Lord about Jesus? Don't that make better sense than making a fool out of yourself? That's all this healing. You come to our church, you can be healed. Come to our church, you can be healed. Be healed, be healed, be healed. And it's all to think about. And I'm not saying God can't heal. I'm not saying God couldn't raise a kid from the dead. He could if he chose to. But somebody got to die sometime and stay dead. Amen. Everybody would always be here. So let's get that vision for 2020. Come on, Miss Desi, while she's coming. The kids need us, y'all. The ship is sinking. I wonder what you'd have thought if you'd seen the Titanic that night after it got hit by the iceberg and the ship was sinking and the captain sitting here playing chess. Hey man, don't you know the ship's sinking? That's what we're doing. The ship is sinking. And most people are just totally oblivious. This world is in worse shape right now than it's ever been in history. I don't see how Sodom and Gomorrah could have been even close to where this world is today. We can't even talk about it in public. God give us 2020 vision. I wonder who'd start this new year off right. I wonder who'd say, Brother Danny, in this year, by the grace of God, I'm going to buckle down. And I'm going to start this year off right. I ain't going to mess around no more. Let's stand. Let's stand this morning. Let's all stand. If you need to come, let's gather around this altar. This is the last Sunday of the year. Let's start out the new year right this morning. Would you do that? Would you do that this morning? Amen. Husbands and wives, teenagers, what a blessing. What a blessing. Teenagers coming this morning. Maybe you're here this morning, you say, Brother Danny, I've really messed up. I've really messed up. Dear God, have mercy on me. Well, just come and get that life right with God this morning. Come on. Come on right now. Just get down here and say, God, I want to start this. Ain't no telling what we're liable to see in this next year. There is no telling. You're down here praying. You ask God to forgive you. You ask God to make sure that you're saved, and you ask him to make sure that you're right and that you're living for the Lord. Would you do that? Would you do that? He'll bless you for it if you will. Amen. Anybody else? Anybody else? Heavenly Father, I pray right now in Jesus' name that you bless every single person on this altar this morning. I pray, God, as we begin this new year, God, that you'd give us grace. God, that you'd give us glory and that you'd give us power to live for you and serve you and do right. I pray, God, in Jesus' name, Lord, that you'd bless all these on the altar this morning. God, give them their heart's desire. I pray for that teenager here this morning, or that teenage boy, or that mama, or that daddy, or that boy or girl, or that husband or wife. Oh, Lord, please, 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 God, do a work in their heart this morning. Send them out of here to do something for you, Lord. God, don't let one of us leave the way they can. The world's drowning. This old world's going down. God, give us grace to stay afloat and to live for you and serve you in these last days. Whatever you do, we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. For his sake. Are you still praying this morning? They'll pray as long as they need to.